Praise God. It's good to be here this Sunday. I always enjoy coming to the River of Love. Thank Andrew and the worship team for awesome worship this morning. You guys have a great church. See, sometimes we go to church all the time and it becomes kind of just same to us. Or sometimes we compare our church to other churches and we underestimate ourselves and we undersell ourselves. And when you come to visit a church, you recognize the greatness of that church. And you guys have a great church here. You need to believe in your church. You need to believe that God has a purpose and destiny for this church. Don't short sell yourself. Don't compare yourself to another Christian. Don't compare your church to another church. This is a unique church with a unique calling and a unique destiny on this church. And so I just want to encourage you in the Lord. You know, get excited about your church. Just don't roll in here. This is another Sunday like every other Sunday. No, get pumped about your church. You know, don't wait until your church is full to get excited about your church. You have to get excited about your church now so your church gets full. You know, if you wait till your church is full to get excited, it's never going to happen. You got to get excited now about your church. You know, I see you got your ropes up back there. I'm glad to see that. I don't know if I want to use the word hate or not. That's a very strong word. But I hate people who sit in the back row of the church. Because that to me speaks a message to me that I'm not really into the church. You know. I mean, when I was excited about Jesus in church, I was up in the front row because the anointing is strongest in the front, you know. And in most churches, I find that people who sit in the back row are often on their way out. I watch in churches, new people in the church, they're pumped and excited about the church, man. They're up front, man. They're just getting into worship and everything else. And then after about a year or two, you see them moving to the middle of the church, and then after they move into the back of the church, and then one day they're gone, you know. And so don't sit in the back of the church, man. In my church, I get on people's cases that sit in the back of the church. I say, you know, what's happening here? You know, are you on your way out? You know, oh, no, we're not on our way out. Yeah, well, then just move up, you know. So
I'm going to remember that.
Hallelujah. So if you're a back pew sitter, I encourage you to move up. Amen. Get excited about your church. You got an awesome church, got an awesome worship, got awesome pastors. Praise God. Today I want to talk about out of the box is the title of my sermon. I just want to pray before we start. Holy Spirit, we just invite you. We don't invite you in this place. You're already in this place. But Holy Spirit, I pray that you'll help me to clearly enunciate what you want to say this morning and help every person here to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is speaking to the church today. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to ask the PowerPoint team to put up the picture of the box. I call it the box of limitations. Now, don't you like that box? That is my artistic work, you know. Now, the writing on it is my wife's. My penmanship is terrible. If I'd written that, you could not even read whatever. My penmanship has gotten so bad, but most of the time I have a hard time reading what I write. You know, because I do everything on computers, my notepad and everything else anymore. I write less and less, and the less I write, the worse it gets. So the writing is my wife. The artistic work is mine, you know. And so the person in the middle of the box represents you and represents your church. And so the message I'm going to talk about this morning, you can apply it to you individually, but it also applies to us as a church, as a corporate body. And so I want to begin this morning by talking about limitations in our lives. And these limitations I'm going to talk about are very true limitations. And I've kind of boiled it down to four areas of limitations. The first area is people. Now, I have people across the top. And you know, God is outside of our box. You know, God is unlimited. If you were to take a line from one edge of the box here, or all right, God, and you would just take that line and you would go out into space for eternity, you would never find the end of God. That is how great and awesome God is. God lives outside of our box. God is not limited by our box, because he's not limited by our limitations. And all the promises of God are outside the box, because God intentionally gives promises that we cannot fulfill ourselves. The only way we can fulfill the promises or walk into the promises of God is to get out of the box, because God is the only one who can fulfill the promise. Prophetic word is always outside the box. If you receive a prophetic word that you can do yourself, it's not a prophetic word from God. God's prophetic word is always outside the box, because that is where God lives. God lives and operates outside of our box. So one of the major limitations that we all face are people. You know, as soon as you try to get out of the box, people are going to be the first thing that are going to try to stop you. And because people, and mostly it's people that are closest to you, because the people that are closest to you know your limitations. So as soon as you try to do something that is beyond yourself, they're going to be quick to remind you of your limitations. And so, you know, we oftentimes allow the voice of people around us to hinder us from stepping out. You know, I can imagine when Peter got ready to step out of the boat and walk on water, that all the other 11 guys in the boat just said, "Hey, Peter, you're totally a lunatic to try to get out of this boat, because we cannot walk on water." And then when Peter went down in the water and he got, and Jesus put him back on the boat, I'm sure all his friends were quick to remind him, "I told you so, Peter, we can't walk on water." You see, and those kinds of comments build limitations on our lives. Brick by brick, they build limitations. People from our past experiences with people that have spoken into our lives, build limitations into our lives. Brick by brick, they build this limitation in our life, and people begin to define who we are instead of God defining who we are. And so when God calls us outside the box, our past, the people who have spoken to us in the past, and people who are speaking to us currently, all work against us getting out of our box into what God has promised or prophesied over our lives. That's the same thing with the church. The second area of limitations is experience, or I put up their habits. It can be habits, experiences, and structures. Experiences are things that oftentimes are limits in our lives. Our past bad experiences, every time we have a bad experience or a failure in our lives, it puts a brick in our wall of limitations. Because as soon as we've stepped out and done something, we failed, we make sure that we don't step out and do that again. So when God calls us to step out again in the area of failure, we're more reticent to step out because of that failure. But it's not only negative experiences, it's also positive experiences. Because what happens is, with a positive experience, we also make that a brick in our wall of limitation, because then we operate according to our experience rather than what God is speaking to us in the present. In other words, this worked in the past, so it must work again. But when God says, "I want you to do something new," we're reticent to do it because this worked in the past. So we try to repeat the past experiences, and we try to avoid the past negative experiences. Both those experiences hinder us from moving into what God has for us in the present. Many of those experiences we have develop into habits in our life. So we begin to do the same thing over and over again. We get comfortable in that habit that we have. And so when God calls us to do something that's not habitual as an individual or as a church, then we fail to move into that because we just tend to move according to habits in our lives. Structures, we develop structures in our lives. Structures are very comfortable for us. Structures support us in our life. You know, we just had the inauguration of President Trump, you know, and the Capitol building has had scaffolding around it for several years. Well, that scaffolding is not made to stay there forever. The scaffolding was just there to renovate the building, and I'm glad the scaffolding was gone before inauguration. But you see, we build scaffolding in our lives. We build scaffolding in our lives to support ourselves, but we can't. The problem is we fail to take down the scaffolding that we built in our lives. And so we can't move on to the future of what God wants us to do because of our experiences, because of our habits, and because of our structures. You know, as a church, we need to be careful because as individuals and as a corporate body, as a church, oftentimes our past defines our future. And so as a church body, you have been through some things in the past, good things and bad things. And if you're not careful, your past then defines your future, and you can't move into the future that God has for you. So your past experiences with people, your past experiences with situations, things that have happened, and a lot of things have happened. You who have been in this church for a while, a lot of things have happened in this church over the years, good things and bad things. And you need to be careful that those things do not hinder you from moving into the future that God has for you. So we have these things that become limitations in our life from moving into what God has for us. So the third thing that we have is our circumstances. Whereas habits and experiences and structures come from the past, circumstances are what we have today. So oftentimes the circumstances that we are in hinder us from moving into the future. It may be our job, challenges we're facing in our job. It may be challenges we're facing with our family. It may be challenges we're facing with our marriage. You know, it's other circumstances in our life. Sometimes it's circumstances that are beyond our control, that are happening in our life, but they're hindering us from moving into what God has for us. And the last one is resources, or as the Bible would put it, provision. And we all think if we had more something, we could do more. If we had more money or more time or more training or more experience, then we could do something greater. And so we often look at our lack of resources as inhibiting us from moving into the presence of God or moving into what God has for us. And you know, and I'm not denying these things. All of these things are real in our lives. But the problem is we allow those things to produce limitations into moving into what God has for us. When I was I don't know if some of you may have had a radical conversion experience in your life that really, you just will transform from one thing to another thing. I got saved when I was young, when I was a child. And so even though it was a memorable occasion, it was not a radical change. But I was radically changed when I was filled with the Holy Spirit. Between sixth and seventh grade, I went to a camp, and I was radically filled with the Holy Spirit. I mean, I just didn't get a little dab. I got a full dose. I went down, the Spirit speaking in tongues, and I came up 3 hours later, and I've been speaking in tongues and prophesying for 3 hours, and I didn't even know it. And it radically changed my life in every area. I became radical about Jesus, but I went from being a CDF student to being an ABC student. I went from warming the bench on the basketball team to being first string on the team. I went from sitting in the back of our youth group to being leader of our youth group. Everything in my life radically changed, and it wasn't that my environment had changed. I didn't change schools. I didn't change churches. I didn't change anything else. But the Holy Spirit redefined who I was. Because before that, I was defined by my grades, which were poor. I was defined by my athletic ability, which was not good. I was defined by my lack of ability to stand up and speak in front of people. All these things had defined me and had built walls of limitations in my life. People, experiences, circumstances, all those things. But when I was radically filled with the Holy Spirit redefined who I was, and he removed all those walls of limitations in our life, and I was the same person, but I excelled in everything. My senior year of high school, we moved to Tulsa, Oklahoma. I became part of a church that had about 100 young people. And in that year, we went from about 100 young people to about 300 young people in our church. We were crazy radical about Jesus. We were radical about Jesus on our high school campuses. I mean, everywhere we went, we were just a bunch of Jesus freaks. That's all we were, you know. And Jesus dominated everything about our lives, and people wanted to be part of what we were doing. I currently am discipling about 45 guys at the Petersburg Federal Prison. I've been discipling them once a week for the last 3 years. And this group of 45 guys, man, they have gotten radical about Jesus. They are the most popular gang in the prison right now. And they have gangs in prison.
Oh, yeah.
They do, I will tell you. And they are now the most popular gang in the prison. And people are getting, they have 10 units in this prison. They have daily Bible studies and prayer meetings in each of those units. Most of them have 50 or more people in each one. God is doing a radical thing in them. God, you know, they all came in as failures. But God is redefining them by the Word and by the Holy Spirit. Now, one of them by the name of Levi, I have in my group of 45, 7 spiritual reps. See, I didn't use the word elders or deacons because that carries a whole bunch of garbage on it. As soon as you use the word elder, deacon, man, you put definition on it. You put limitations. You put borders. You put all kinds of crap on that stuff. And so I chose the word spiritual reps. You are 7 spiritual reps. Well, one of them was named by the name of Levi. And Levi has served 16 years in prison. And he's just been moved to a camp for 6 months before he's released. And in the camp, he's allowed limited access to go out and do things. And so he's gotten a job at Chick-fil-A at South Park Mall. And a van takes him to Chick-fil-A, and then a van picks him up and takes him back to the camp. Well, 2 days a week, he works a lunch shift, and he works an evening shift, and he has about a 3-hour break in between. Well, the van does not want to pick him up, take him back to the camp, bring him back in again. So they just bring him in before lunch, and they take him in after the supper shift he has. And so he has about a 3-hour break every Tuesday and Thursday afternoon. And Levi goes around and he witnesses to everybody. He has gotten to know all the vendors real well. He has started 3 Bible studies with 3 groups of vendors in South Park Mall. He goes up and witnesses the people who are walking to the mall. He'll stop people and pray for them. He'll take people and give them a free lunch at Chick-fil-A. I mean, this guy is radical off the chain. And I joke with the guys in the prison. I say, Levi just hasn't figured out that you don't do those kinds of things in normal life, you know? You see, and we have been, by our culture, we have been pressed back into our box of limitations. Levi has been set free. He doesn't recognize the limitations that are on his life yet, and I hope he never recognizes them again. But you see, the enemy will try, and he's going to get pushback. He may actually lose his job with Chick-fil-A sometime. I don't know. And the enemy is going to try to build a new walls of limitation into Levi's life. But I pray that he's so filled with the Spirit that he will not allow those walls to be built again in his life. See, what happens as we mature in Christ, we become very efficient within our box, but we're less and less reticent to move out of the box. We become very good at what we do in the box. And we get to the place we don't even need God in our box anymore, because we can do it ourselves. We pray and ask God to help us do what's in the box, but we know through maturity and experience and everything else how to operate in our box. When we were young in the Lord, we were willing to get out there and do some crazy stuff outside the box. But through time, we build those walls of limitations, and so we just become very efficient in the box, and we don't get outside of our box of limitations. And so today I want to just spend a few minutes talking about how to get out of our box of limitations. And the first scripture verse I want to look at is Isaiah 43, verse 18 and 19. Isaiah 43, 18 and 19. Says there, Isaiah says, "Do not remember the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert." There's a couple comments I want to make about the scripture verse. He says there that he wants to do a new thing and you will know it. But the way to come into the knowledge of what the new thing is you got to forget the former thing. Whether the former thing was good or bad is not relevant. You have to forget the former thing to move or even recognize the new thing that God has for you. It says, don't remember the former, don't even consider the things of old. You know, we build on past experiences. That's the wrong thing to build on. We are to build on God, not on past experience. Not even our past experiences with God. Because God wants to do a new thing in us. He wants to do a new thing in our lives. But as long as we look back to what is past, we will never move into what God has for us in the future. Experience is good in developing our character, but it's not what we build our life on. It's not what we build our future on. The second thing I want to mention is that he says, I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. God does not say he's going to take us out of our wilderness or our desert. See, we want God to change our circumstance. God, if you will change my circumstances, then everything is going to be good. No, God doesn't promise that. God says, no, I'm going to make a road in your wilderness. I'm going to make a river in your desert. And why does God do that? It's because God doesn't want our circumstances or environment to control us. God wants us to control and influence our circumstances or environment. See, when the river comes into the desert, the river brings life into the desert. And I just want you to kind of file that phrase away. He's going to make rivers in your desert. Because I'm going to refer back to that as we go on. So Don't pray for God to change your circumstances. Pray for God to intervene in your circumstances. Pray for God to begin to operate and bring life into your circumstances. See, God doesn't want you to quit your job, no matter what a hell job you have. God wants to bring life into your job. See, I'll talk about that later. I get ahead of myself here. So, you know, don't pray for God to change wherever you're at. Ask God by His Spirit to intervene wherever you're at. 1 Corinthians 2, 9 and 10. Says, but as it is written, eye has not seen nor ear heard, nor has it entered the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love Him. You can't even imagine what God has planned for you. But God has revealed them to us through His Spirit. So the revelation of what God wants to do comes through His Spirit. God wants to do a new thing in us in 2017. Something we can't even imagine because it's outside of our box. We can't imagine it. See, we can imagine what's happened in our box. We can imagine what we've experienced before. We can imagine that because we've been there before. See, God called Abraham to a country he did not know. He called him into an environment that was outside of his control, that he did not understand, that he had not walked through before. But you see, we are afraid to leave the place that we know and go to the place that we don't know, because the place we don't know is not secure. It's unknown. But to move out of our box of limitations into the limitless God, to come into the promises of God, to have the prophetic word fulfilled over our lives and our church, we cannot build on our experiences. We have to be willing to move out into the limitlessness of God so that He can begin to do the supernatural thing in our lives by His Holy Spirit. God wants to show us something that we cannot even imagine or think by the Holy Spirit. I've done a series of sermons beginning this year. I have a radio broadcast called Voice of Hope that I do in Kenya. And you can get it on it's just 15-minute sermons. You can even listen to them on my website, which is equipping-the-nations.org. My first one was a new year, new perspective, new oil. And God wants to give us a new perspective before He gives us new oil. We have to begin to see ourselves differently. We have to begin to see the people around us differently. We need to begin to see our church differently. We need to begin to see God differently. See, what happens to us, we worship God. We recognize God is great and powerful and awesome and can do anything. And we sit within our box of limitations and we worship the God who's outside the box. But we are unwilling to step out of our box into what He has for us to do. In John, you know, Jesus was a person that lived and operated outside of the box. Jesus just crushed religious traditions of His day. He got out there in the public, he got there in the street, he hung out with people that religious people never hung out with, people who could not get inside the synagogue, people who could not get inside the temple, people who were ostracized by the religious structures of their day. And Jesus hung out with all those people all the time, 24/7, and He hung out there in the power and authority of God. And that's why thousands and thousands followed Him. The thousands who followed Him did not have access to the religious structures of His day. They couldn't get in because the walls were way too high for them to get in. The demands and pressures put on them, they did not feel comfortable. Matthew, the tax collector, could never get into a synagogue, or much less the temple. Zacchaeus could never get into the temple. They were outside. They were foreign. They wouldn't even feel comfortable inside there. Jesus got into Zacchaeus. He called Matthew. He called Matthew to be a follower of his when Matthew was a tax collector. He didn't say, Matthew, you need to go to church for 2 years and prove yourself faithful, then you can be my disciple. No, he called Matthew to be one of the 12 as a tax collector. When Matthew was all screwed up, he's chosen to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. Why? Because God needed Matthew to reach Zacchaeus. That's a whole other sermon. But anyway, John 14, 7 through 17. I'll just read through this quickly, and you'll have to forgive me if I go a little long today. You can invite me back several months from now after you've recovered. But John chapter 14, verse 7 through 17, it's a portion we know well, but it really lays out how we move out of our box of limitations into God's unlimitedness. Jesus says in verse 7, he's talking to the disciples, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. And then Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it's sufficient for us. I mean, these guys are a bunch of dopes, man. I don't know where his problem. Philip has a real problem here. Jesus just said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. And Philip says, show us the Father. We're going to be satisfied. You know, I mean, really help me out, Philip. I mean, I think sometimes Jesus just wanted to take his gun out and just shoot the guy in the head. You know, I mean, what is wrong with you, Philip? I just said it to you. You know, what, you don't get it, man. What's happening to you? I mean, I don't know how Jesus put up with his disciples sometimes. Verse 19. So Jesus is patient. Jesus just repeats himself again. Jesus said to him, have I not been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show me the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words I speak, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe in me, I am in the Father, and the Father is in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. So Jesus lays out the example. Says, the reason I am successful in everything I do is because I only speak and do what the Father tells me to speak and the Father tells me to do. It's not about my agenda. It's not about my program. It's not about my experience. It's not about anything else. One thing, I just do what the Father tells me to do, and I just say what the Father tells me to say. So I have 100% success rate in everything I do. I am not defined by people. I'm not defined by religious structures. I'm not defined by other people's opinion. I'm not defined by my experiences. I'm not defined by resources, whether I have a lot or any resource. I'm not defined by any of those things. I am defined by my Father God. And I only do and say what he tells me to do and what he tells me to say. This is the example. This is the example I'm setting out to you. Then he transfers it to us. And verse 12 says, most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these will he do because I go to my Father. And whatever you ask in my name, I will do in the Father, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you will ask anything in my name, I will do it. And if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you a helper, that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells in you and will be in you. So Jesus lays out how we can walk in the same way that he walked. And he said, the key thing is right there, stuck in verse 15. If you love me, you keep my commandments. He says, then I will pray the Father, and he'll send you a helper. See, to move out of the box into the unlimitedness of God requires, first of all, obedience on our part. Doesn't require us getting jazzed up by the Holy Spirit. It's not what it requires. It requires just simple obedience. It says, when you obey what I ask you to do, When you do what I ask you and you step out of the box, then you step out of your limitations into my limitlessness. Then the Holy Spirit comes alongside and enables you to do the impossible. See, we want the enablement before we step out of the box. No, the enablement doesn't come with when you're in the box, because you don't need divine enablement in the box, because you can do it yourself in the box. If you love me, you will do what I say, and then I will send the helper. And then you will do the impossible. Anything you ask for, I will do it. 100%. We say, man, that is so far out. That is so impossible. You mean everything I ask for? Everything, 100%. 100%. Everything Jesus asked for, he got 100%. God never said no. Why? Because he only did what the Father told him to do, and he only spoke what the Father told him to speak. He did the obedience part, and the Holy Spirit came behind to do what only God can do. See, God wants us to move, but you have to take that step of faith and obedience and step out of the box. You know, again, I love Peter, because Peter got out of the boat. And he, I don't know how far he walked on water before he went down. He may have walked just a couple feet. He may have walked a few yards. I don't know how far he walked. You know, and I think when he went down, all he had to do was holler, help, help. And Jesus grabbed his hand, put him back in the boat. And even though Jesus fussed at him a little bit, I think Jesus was pretty proud of Peter that he was willing to get out of the boat, you know. And the thing is, you never walk on water until you get out of the boat. Never happened. You can look out and you can pray about walking on water, and you can dream about walking on water. You can prophesy about walking on water. You can do all that stuff about. You can get in church and worship the great God who can walk on, help you walk on water. But you'll never walk on water until you get out of the boat. You have to make the move to get out of the boat. You have to get out of the place of your comfort zone and do something you've never done before. As an individual and as a church, if we are to move into the limitless of God, we have to move into this fullness of what God has for us. In John chapter 3, verse 34, and I want to look at this in the New King James Version and in the New Living Translation. It says, For he whom God has sent speaks the words of God, for God does not give him the Spirit by measure. This is referring to Jesus. For he, Jesus, whom God has sent, speaks the word of God, for God does not give the Spirit by measure. In John, in the New Living Translation, it says, for he is sent by God, he, Jesus, is sent by God, he speaks God's word, for God does not give him the Spirit without limit. And I want to illustrate to you what, and all of you have been wondering why I brought my own water. I just didn't bring it to drink, even though I did drink some of it. I brought it to give an illustration of the Spirit without limit, or the Spirit. Jesus had the Spirit without limit, or without measure. That's why he did what he did. And I want to illustrate the difference between being filled with the Spirit and being baptized with the Spirit. So this picture represents the Spirit without limit. No limit to this. You know, it's a bottomless picture. You know, there's no limit to this picture. This is a Spirit without limit. This is us. This is you and me. We have limitations. We all have limitations. This is the limited. This is the box here. And so what happens with us is we want to do the Holy Spirit to help us do something. So we ask for the Holy Spirit's help. And so we come to church on Sunday and we get a little dose of the Holy Spirit, okay? And then we go out during the week and the Holy Spirit helps us through our prayers and maybe anoints us to do something or something else, and we carry the Holy Spirit through the week and the Holy Spirit helps with things. And as the week rolls on, we start to get kind of dried up because of all the problems and issues of life that kind of beat us all down. Our cup gets empty. We get kind of dry and drained and all that other stuff. And we got to go back to church and get a little more of the Holy Spirit for the next week, you know. And, you know, we're constantly getting worn out, discouraged, dried up. Because we come and we get a measure of the Holy Spirit. Having the Holy Spirit without measure means we are baptized in the Holy Spirit. It is no longer the Holy Spirit pouring into us and then us pouring out into our circumstances and other people's lives. But we pour without measure. And the reason we don't get baptized in the Spirit like that is because when you get baptized in the Spirit, it's no longer you anymore. You have no longer any control over your life. It is exactly where the Holy Spirit, wherever the Holy Spirit wants to go, whatever the Holy Spirit wants to do, whenever the Holy Spirit wants to pour out. You have no say over it all anymore. You see, for most of us, we are not willing to go there. We want to keep control. So we take the Spirit by measure, and we do what we want to do and ask the Holy Spirit to help us do what we want to do. Our failure to give up control is what keeps us from having the Spirit without measure. See, Jesus had the Spirit without measure because Jesus had absolutely no control over his life. None. None whatsoever. He only did what the Father told him to do. He only spoke what the Father told him to speak. He only poured out when the Holy Spirit poured out. He never poured out of his own volition, of his own desire to accomplish his own agenda and his own means. If we are to move out of our box of limitations into the fullness of God, we have to fully yield to the Holy Spirit, where it's no longer about the Holy Spirit, but it's no longer about us, but it's about the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit wants to do in our lives. In John 3:8, Jesus said, "The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit." You don't have any control over the wind. The wind goes where it wants. It does what it wants to do. And all you can do is flow with the Holy Spirit. See, and you say, "Man, how can I do that? I have all this stuff in my life. I'm a busy person. I have my job, my marriage, my family, all this other stuff going on in my life. How can I do that?" See, God is not calling you to give up your job. God is not calling you to divorce your wife or to give up your family. But what God is asking you is that you allow His Holy Spirit to take control of your job. The Holy Spirit becomes the default setting in your life. So that on your job, you do on your job whatever the Holy Spirit asks you to do on your job. Because the Holy Spirit becomes preeminent on your job. If the Holy Spirit asks you to pray for somebody, you pray for them. The Holy Spirit asks a word of encouragement, you do that. If the Holy Spirit asks you to witness to somebody, you do that. You know, you see, your job situation wants to put limits on your life. Your job situation wants you to confine the Holy Spirit to the box. But the Holy Spirit wants to move on your job. The Holy Spirit wants to influence lives on your job. Your marriage. The Holy Spirit wants to influence your marriage. The Holy Spirit wants to accentuate your marriage. But you see, we have let our culture define our marriage. So we think married life has to operate in a certain way. So we define this as a good marriage. You got to spend so much time together, go see the movies together, go do sports together, all these things together, and then you're going to have a successful marriage. Well, that's culturally, and so we get involved in all this stuff trying to produce a good marriage. No, a good marriage is a marriage that is controlled by the Holy Spirit. Whereas a couple, you're not just going to a movie just to spend time together. Or you're not watching... My wife loves to watch these Hallmark movies. Lord help me. So I become a Hallmark movie watcher. I sit there and I watch the Hallmark movie because my wife loves Hallmark movies, you know. But but we quit trying to do those cultural things to make our marriage work. And we as a couple begin to move. But you see, if you take all your time trying to do a culture thing, it's a box. And it's actually hindering you from moving into the fullness of what God has for you as a couple. Same thing as a family. We need to get our kids involved in sports and all this stuff, man. Sports mom just running all over the place doing this thing. Our children in concert playing their flute and doing all this other stuff, man. We're just going like, wow, we don't have time for the Holy Spirit. We don't have time to pray. We don't have time to read our word. We are just trying to take care of our children, you know. I have a good friend of mine in a house of prayer. Not there any long left years ago. He led Royal Rangers in our church. Royal Rangers. He gave his life to Royal Rangers because he had five boys. And he invested in those five boys, spent time with those five boys. They went hunting and camping and did all the Royal Rangers stuff together, man. They moved up right to the top of Royal Rangers, everything excelled Royal Rangers. Not one of his five boys are serving God today. Why? Because Royal Rangers is first, not Jesus first. See, God wants us to move with our kids with the Holy Spirit. God has a purpose and plan for our children by the Holy Spirit. But you see, we buy into the culture. This is how you raise our kids in our culture. And so we work within the box of our limitations, and we wonder why we get all these bad results. You know, God wants to move out of our box. You know, and it's a scary thing to move out of a box because everything in our life and our culture and the people around us, our circumstances, our experiences, our habits, our reason, everything defines our box. If we're not careful, our walls of our box just get bigger and bigger until we can hardly see out of them anymore, much less move out of them. I want to end by reading one last scripture verse, and then we'll conclude for today. I'm going to read from Ezekiel chapter 47, verse 1 through 12. Holy Spirit, speak to us today. Spirit of God, speak to us today. Holy Spirit, we need you in our lives, our marriages, our job, our families, our church, Lord God. Ezekiel 47, 1 through 2. It says, then he brought me back to the door of the temple, and there was water flowing from under the threshold of the temple toward the east. For the front of the temple faced east, and the water was flowing from under the right side of the temple, south of the altar. And he brought me out by the way of the north gate, and he led me around the outside to the outer gateway that faces east, and there was water running out the right side. And when the man went out to the east with a line in his hand, he measured 1,000 cubits, and he brought me through the water, and the water was up to my ankles. Again he measured 1,000, and he brought me to the waters, and the waters came up to my knees. Then he measured another 1,000 and brought me out, and the water came up to my waist. Again he measured 1,000, and it was a river that I could not cross, for the water was too deep. Water which was one must swim in, a river that could not be crossed. And he said to me, son of man, have you seen this? Then he brought me and returned me to the bank of the river. When I returned there along the bank of the river, there was very many trees on the side and the other. Then he said to me, this water flows toward the eastern region, going down into the valley and enters the sea. When it reaches the sea, its waters are healed. Sea always represents people and nations. And it shall be that every living thing that moves wherever the river goes will live. There will be great multitudes of fish, because these waters go there, for they will be healed, and everything will live wherever the river goes. It shall be that fishermen will stand by it on the Engedi to whatever the name is. They will be places for spreading their nets. The fish will be of the same kinds as the fish of the great sea, exceedingly many. But the swamps and marshes will not be healed, for they be given over to Saul. Along the bank of the river and on the side, and that will grow all kinds of trees used for food. Their leaves will not wither, and their fruit will not fail. They will bear fruit every month because their water flows from the sanctuary. Their fruit will be for food, and their leaves for medicine. I want to tell you, we live in a day when the Spirit of God, the living water of God, is flowing from the throne of God over the earth today. Flowing to bring life is flowing to bring healing. And you notice that the angel or whoever it was that was talking to them took him to ankle-deep water, then knee-deep water, then waist-deep water, and then finally so deep that he could not walk on the ground anymore. And you know, in our lives, in our relationship with the Holy Spirit, we love ankle-deep water. We love to just get a little dab of the Holy Spirit. Just a little feel-good, hallelujah, glory, praise God, woo, ha, glory. And we just love to feel good, that little bit of ankle. Or maybe we get so excited, we actually get in knee-deep, man. Ooh, man, this is exciting, glory, God, hallelujah. You know, or maybe we even get waist in. You know, the problem is on all those levels, we still have control over our lives because our feet are still on the bottom. But God is calling us to a place where we are willing to get into the water where we cannot touch the bottom anymore, where we have no more control over our lives, but we flow with the Holy Spirit. Because once you get in that place, you become one with the river. And everywhere you go, life goes. Wherever you go, healing goes. And you are part of the movement of the Holy Spirit that is going to bring life to the sea of humanity. And we have a decision to make in these last days. If we are going to go ankle deep, knee deep, waist deep, or whether we're going to give up totally to the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is moving. You say, what does that look like, Andy? I can't tell you what it looks like because it looks like different for each one of us. That's why I can't follow someone else's example. People do not define who I am and what I do. The river defines who I am and what I do. The river defined who Jesus was and what he did. Doesn't mean an abandonment of all structure of what you do, but it means that the river influences everything you do. God said, forget the former things. Forget the things of old. Behold, I want to do a new thing. I'm going to show it to you. I'm going to make even a river in the desert. And that is what God's going to do in this last day. Do you think things are going to get better? Things are going to get worse in this world. It's going to turn from wilderness to desert in this world. But God is bringing a river from the throne of God that's going to flow through the desert, and it's going to bring life to the desert. And he's calling us into that river. So you have to decide, is this who you are, or is this who you are? Are you asking for a little bit of the Holy Spirit to do what you want to do, or are you fully yielded? Your job, your marriage, your family, your kids, everything. Getting into the river all the way, you know? If you ain't even ankle deep, just get in at least ankle deep, you know? Start out, you know? I'm not asking you to jump in all the way, you know? I learned to swim back when I learned to swim. My swim instructor, when I was just a little kid, man, I was about 2 years old, he just threw me in the pool. And I swam, you know, because I have a natural instinct to swim. You know, other instructors, they want to ease you in, you know, but sometimes we just jump in and sometimes we ease in. But I just want to challenge you today as a church. You have a great church. The Spirit of God is in this place. But in 2017, God wants to take you as an individual outside of your box. He just doesn't want to increase the size of your box. He wants to take you outside of the box. And it begins with those simple steps of obedience. Well, first of all, it begins with awareness of the Holy Spirit, a change of perspective. But then it just takes those simple steps of obedience on a daily basis. When you feel that prompting of the Holy Spirit to do something, say something that is outside of your norm. And you're willing to yield to the Holy Spirit, no matter what anybody else thinks or no matter what the consequences are. Father, I thank you for this church. Lord, this church is divinely established by you right here, Lord God. Lord, you have an awesome purpose and destiny for this church. We thank you today that we live in the greatest days of the history of the church, Lord God. Your church is exploding around the world today. Lord, we thank you that the river that has flowed from the throne and room of God is getting wider and bigger all the time, Lord Jesus. Lord, help each of us who are here, myself, all of us who are here, to be able to just jump in that river, Lord God. Father, just help us, Lord, to not just stay within the bounds of our limitations, Lord God, but help us, Lord, to trust you, to yield to your Holy Spirit, and get out there where you are, God, where you're working and where you're operating, where you're bringing healing, deliverance, and salvation, Lord God. Lord, we just worship you today. We glorify your name because you are an amazing God, Lord God. We know you're amazing, and help us to move into that amazement with you, Lord God. Lord, we love you today. We glorify you today. I pray, Lord, for this church, Lord God, that you'll just, as they go into 2017, I pray that you'll just do a new thing in this church, Lord God. May they forget the old and move into what you have for them. May you begin to show them by the Spirit, and may they have the courage to move into what you have for them. In Jesus' name, amen.